like to welcome you to worship here at First United Methodist Church in Los Alamos. A special welcome to our guests this morning. I'm Reverend John Nash. I'm not with you this morning as I am off visiting with some family. But I'm glad that you are here with us, and for those who are worshiping with us online, thank you for welcoming us into your home or wherever it is you're gathered for worship this morning. Valerie Collins, our director of music, will be giving the message this morning, and she'll be assisted in worship also by Philip, our director of faith development. First Light this morning is made up of Valerie, Nels, and Greg. Kathy is our lay reader. In the sound booth, we have Don, Dennis, James, and Linda, and Tom and Vicky are ushers. So thank you to them for their worship leadership this morning. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, said, "Whoever you are and whatever faith you were born, whatever creed you confess, if you have come here to find God, to encounter God, you are welcome here, and we are indeed glad that you are with us today." We planned a great worship service for you as we continue in the series on the fruit of the Spirit, moving this week onto the fruit of peace. And so we hope that you have come with the expectation that we will encounter the risen Christ, that the Holy Spirit will be moving and working amongst us here this morning, that we will be transformed simply by gathering together as the body of Christ. And so I'm going to invite you to stand as you are comfortable. Remain seated if that's more comfortable, as Kathy comes forward to lead us in our opening prayer.
Together, let us pray. O Heavenly Prince of Peace, we come this day to worship the glory of your name and to celebrate your holy splendor. Just as you called the disciples and apostles, so too you call to us and invite us to be agents of your grace and mercy, to be your love to the world by living in peace with everyone. Help us to put away our fears and turn our troubles over to you, so that we may pick up our cross and follow you this day and every day. Amen. For those in the sanctuary, as we sing, you are invited to come forward to light a candle of joy, hope, or concern, whatever it might be that we need to lift up to the Lord. And if you have a prayer concern or a celebration to be lifted up in prayer later in service, you may fill out a prayer card that you will find in the pews, which will be collected during the third song. Those worshiping online are also encouraged to light a candle where you are and to put your prayer concerns and celebrations into the comment section. We are called to be holy as God is holy, and we come to worship Jesus, who is our Prince of Peace.
You know, when King David brought the Ark of the Covenant up to Jerusalem for the first time and put it in a tent he had made for it, and he appointed the Levites to minister before the Ark, he told them to sing a song. He said, "Sing like this, sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day, for the Lord is mighty and worthy to be praised." So we're going to sing to the Lord now. We don't know what that song sounded like so long ago. I like to think it sounded a little bit like this.
You are worthy. You are mighty. 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 You are worthy. our life for you, when we live our life for you, it means that we look to you, we come to worship, we practice together prayer and study, and as we are able to bask in your presence and in your spirit, we know that we will be covered and protected and comforted even in the eye of the storm.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. When I realize I've been sold out by my friends and my family, I can feel the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. Test comes in and the doctor says I've only got a few months left. It's like a bitter pill I'm swallowing, I can barely take a breath. When addiction steals my baby girl and there's nothing I can do, my only hope is to trust you. I trust you, Lord. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. You remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Amen. Thank you. Lord, we are so in need of your presence and your peace, so that we will be able to say, it is well with my soul. Jesus quaked before. Moved by the sound of his voice, seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my reward. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea.
You go to God and pray with me. Dear Lord, many of us come with different things in our hearts today. this morning in the middle of a storm. Others come with joy. Others come with sadness. Others come with happiness. Lord, we learned last week that happiness and joy are two different things. But we can all sing, "It is well with my soul." It is well with our soul. Because we know where our comfort comes from. We know where our foundation is, and that's in you. And so as we gather as one body, as one people, like Nell said, we come and we sing glory to you. Not because we have to, not because it's always easy, but because we get to. Because we felt your mercy and your grace and your love, and the least we can do is say thank you. And so as we continue in worship and to learn together and to be a community of faith, I ask that you continue to walk with us and to lead us and guide us. Because only you can stand with us in the waves and stand next to us on the top of a mountain and celebrate. I pray this all in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
You give me today, we hear again from Paul's list of the fruit of the Spirit, around which our worship series is based. This passage is a little longer than what we have heard before, as the list of the works of flesh are also included, since they are directly applicable to thinking about the fruit of peace, and Paul's advice that we be crucified with Christ, so that it is no longer we who live, but it is Christ who lives in us. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other,
to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. Our gospel passage comes from the 14th chapter of John. Just like the passages from the past 2 weeks, this too is a part of the farewell discourse given on Jesus' last night after he has washed the disciples' feet and promised them the coming of the Spirit, who will be our advocate, who will be God's presence in the world, and who will guide us into the truth. Judas, not Iscariot, said to Jesus, "Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the good news of Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Good morning. Maybe I should repeat that. Peace be with you. We are familiar with this exchange in the church, but what do we really mean when we say these words? Merriam-Webster defines peace as a state of tranquility or quiet, freedom from civil disturbance, a state of security or order within a community provided for by law or custom, freedom from disquieting or oppressive thoughts or emotions, harmony in personal relations, also a state or a period of mutual concord between governments, a pact or agreement to end hostilities between those who have been at war or in a state of enmity. There are also different types of peace. Think of the peace that comes with a conqueror, or death, or a dictator, or a tranquilizer, or something substance-induced, or perhaps simply a withdrawal from the conflict, but without resolution. And we often speak of national, world, and personal peace. So what do we mean when we say, "Peace be with you"? Is it, may you have tranquility and quiet? May your mind be at rest? May your relationships be in harmony? Or perhaps we can substitute one of these other synonyms, calm be with you, order be with you, accord, unity, or stillness be with you. Any of these could be what we mean and what we wish for those we encounter. But as believers, in John 14, Jesus tells us that the peace he gives is not as the world gives. So let's dig deeper. The two words most often translated as peace in the Bible are the Greek word eirene and the Hebrew word shalom.
Eirene is used to denote peace, prosperity, quietness, rest, harmony, concord, security, safety, prosperity, felicity, stillness, to be at one with yourself, much like the dictionary definitions. Shalom, however, is a greeting of hello or goodbye, and it has connotations not just of peace and harmony, but wholeness and completeness, a state of overall well-being, to be enough, freedom from fear and want, wholeness and harmony in your relationships, and contentment in our relationship with God, with others, and with our creation. Shalom is established and sustained by God and is inherently social. This is the peace that Jesus leaves with his disciples and that Paul calls for in the church. Getting back to John, Jesus tells his disciples that he is leaving them, but that God will send an advocate, the Holy Spirit, to teach and remind them of all Jesus has said to them. An advocate acts as a defense lawyer, a public relations consultant, and a defender who will look out for our best interests. Have we thought of this Holy Spirit in that way? It also seems so much easier said than done, because Jesus tells us to do not be afraid, to not let our hearts be troubled. He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives." If we consider what shalom means, freedom from fear and want, wholeness and harmony in all relationships with God, others, and creation, then maybe letting go of fear really is possible. My question now is, how do we find this peace? Jesus didn't always spell things out for us, but he did provide all the clues, and eventually his followers figured it out and explained things to us. Paul tells us that the Spirit is both where and how we find his peace. When the disciples experienced the infusion of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, they were able to shed their fear and boldly go where no man had gone before. Well, maybe not like Star Trek, but you know what I mean, right? A change happened, and they were changed. One of my sources mentioned that 85% of human history is concerned with war and conflict. Peace is needed so badly, but there must be a change before it can come. A change of heart, a change of mind, a change of power. True everlasting peace comes after experiencing the change of God's grace through salvation. It is through Christ's death and resurrection that we have reconciliation and peace with God. Our relationship is made right and whole via God's grace. This is Christ's free gift to us, but we must receive it. When we accept Christ's forgiveness, we can then experience the peace that he gives as we no longer stand under judgment. That alone is an amazing peace. Being made righteous, the Father and Son can then make their home in us, and the Holy Spirit can fill our lives. By accepting the promise through profession of faith and baptism, we can tap into the peace of God, because the Spirit can begin to work in our lives to drive out fear, worry, and anxiety. We can experience calm, even amid life's storms, and an inner peace that is not dependent on our circumstances. Only those who believe have access to this peace. The world can neither understand nor experience it. I'm not sure we can fully understand it. Paul does say in Philippians that it is a peace that surpasses all understanding. However, we can begin to understand it because we know that it is based on faith and trust in God and Christ Jesus. It is the knowledge of the presence of God in our lives. We have freedom from anxiety and worry when we lean not on our own understanding, but fully rely on God. Maybe some of you remember this visual, I guess. I have a t-shirt at home that has a frog and it says, fully rely on God. If we can do that, perhaps we can let go of our worry and anxiety. This does not mean that we have no role to play. We must choose to trust, to let Christ's peace rule in our hearts and minds, and walk in the Spirit. Letting Christ's peace rule involves using peace as the measurement for our decisions and actions, and actively seeking a peaceful resolution, and asking God for that. This doesn't mean peace at all costs. Jesus also said that he came to bring division and to split families. That's not his ultimate purpose, but because what is necessary to advance the kingdom of God. The call for allegiance to him and his word sometimes brings conflict between believers and non-believers, and even between believers. Sometimes conflict precedes a change that brings peace to a situation. But we have access to the peace of God even during conflict, which will protect our hearts and minds when we do place our trust in his promise. This peace is available to us through the Holy Spirit at all times, in all situations. We simply have to seek it, to trust in it, and to offer it to others. So far, I've primarily focused on personal peace, but Jesus and Paul were actually more concerned with corporate peace, how believers live in community. In his farewell discourse, the larger context for the verses that we read in John, Jesus knows that his disciples do not understand what is about to happen. They will be worried and fearful. But he offers the promise and assurance of his continued presence with them through the Holy Spirit that he will send to instruct and remind them of all he has said to them. The same Spirit is here with us and anywhere that two or more of us are gathered together. Paul provides advice for how we are to live by the Spirit, avoiding fleshly desires which are in opposition to the Spirit. He says that as believers, we are now caught in this conflict between our fleshly desires, those natural, human, sinful impulses that steal our peace and promote conflict. Paul lists 15 works of the flesh in verses 19 through 21 of the fifth chapter of Galatians, of which 8 are concerned with the disruption of unity in the community of believers. They are enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, and envy. He warns believers that practicing these things will prevent us from inheriting the kingdom of God, the blessings that are promised to the children of God. John tells us that all who received him, who believe in his name, he gave the power to become children of God. And in Romans, Paul says that all those led by the Spirit of God are children of God. He also pleads with the Philippians to do all things without murmuring or arguing, so that they may be children of God without blemish, shining like stars amid a perverse and crooked generation. Sounds to me like his advice applies just as much or more to us today. Quarreling, dissensions, factions. We haven't experienced those, have we? No. I think they are all present in this world. But we are called to eschew such works of the flesh and to live by the Spirit, allowing the fruit of the Spirit, love, peace, patience, joy, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control to grow in our lives. How do we live by the Spirit and leave behind the natural inclinations of our fleshly humanity? First, we must recognize and confess our sins, profess faith in Jesus, and be baptized by the Holy Spirit. When we receive forgiveness and reconciliation via God's grace, we are freed from judgment under the law. In today's reading, Paul says, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love, become enslaved to one another. He also reminds us that the entire law is contained in the one command, to love our neighbors as ourselves. We can do this when we remain connected to Christ and walk in step with the Spirit. So second, we need to live together with an attitude of familial friendship, focused on love, forgiveness, reconciliation, and thanksgiving. In one commentary I read, if the Spirit guides and shapes the community, then the community will organically produce fruit formed by the Spirit, flexible and free, radical and inspiring. What a vision that could be for our church. There is also a reciprocal relationship between our private and our corporate experience. Individually, we can connect to Christ in multiple ways to develop a habit of peace. Stopping and reflecting on our blessings, practicing mindfulness, relishing and enjoying the goodness of life, resting in God's goodness, and following Christ's example. Remember the saying, "What would Jesus do?" Those are a few of the ways we can practice peace. Neurologically speaking, practicing mindfulness and meditation strengthens the neural pathways that enhance our feelings of calmness. It also creates a better integration of our bodies and our minds, which increases the awareness of our physical emotions and reactions. This awareness can bring greater peace and harmony within ourselves and our environment. Studies have shown that meditating on God's word leads us to internalize and strengthen the neural pathways that remind us of God's presence in the world. This sets us up to unconsciously expect and observe God's goodness at work. Meditating on compassion and the love of God shows an increase in gamma brain waves. These are the highest frequency brain waves associated with sudden insight and a feeling of our senses being heightened to encompass the full richness of our experiences. Surely, when we are able to access a calm and open frame of mind, we will have an easier time living in harmony with others, willing to listen, suspend judgment, and choose love. In community, we can practice peace by praying together, asking the Holy Spirit to inhabit our hearts and minds, being open to mutual admonishment, serving others, and studying scripture and worshiping together. As Paul reminds us, if we live by the Spirit, let us be guided by the Spirit, and in all things, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Jesus himself said, not to let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. If he said this, then peace must be possible. Yes, I am repeating myself because I think we need to hear it. In some faith groups, it is common to ask, how is it with your soul? And I pray that as you pursue peace of God in your life, the Spirit will produce the fruit of peace, and you will be able to say with confidence, it is well with my soul. So, peace be with you. Shalom and amen.
I'd like you to join us for a moment of discipleship. So in your bulletins, you should have something to write some notes down on. I'm going to encourage you for the next minute to think about something you heard, maybe that stood out to you in Valerie's message, and that maybe you want to apply this week. can also write down something maybe you're doing well. Maybe you do feel that peace that goes beyond all understanding. And so maybe you write that down. But I'm going to encourage you for the next minute. We're going to put a little timer up for you to focus on that and to write something down if you'd like. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we pray for your peace that goes beyond all understanding. And how I wish I could understand that. But we know that through your love and your grace, and through kneeling at your feet, that we can begin to feel it. Maybe not understand it, but we can feel it. And that peace that we strive for to create not only in our own lives, but like Valerie said, corporately, with each other and in community. So as we continue in worship, I'm grateful for Valerie and her message and for your spirit among us. In your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, let's pray the Lord's Prayer. I should have done that. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A couple of quick announcements for you all. Next Sunday, October 16th, we will be doing an animal blessing at noon. So we invite you to bring your pets and animals for a blessing. We will meet outside in the front with a short blessing, and then Pastor John will bless each family and its animals. We have sleeping bags available. Our missions team has collected them to hand out to those who don't have shelter. If you would like to take a bag and carry it in your car, for when you come across someone in need, you can get them. They're right in the back of the sanctuary, right underneath the coat hanger. thank you for being God's love in action. A quick story I have to share with you. Last week, I packed up all of the youth, and we went down to Santa Fe because we had charge conference. And I've learned that the only way to get youth to sit through a boring meeting is to bribe them. And so we went to the mall in Santa Fe. We ate Chinese food. Did the ropes course there in the mall. If you haven't seen it, it's a lot of fun. And then we went to a meeting, and then we had some pizza, and then we drove back, which sounds like a lot of youth just messing around, which kind of was. But on the way back home, we're driving up the mountain, and it's starting to get dark, and you know the whole car is just like talking, and I hear William and Sam debating how difficult it is to have faith in school, how it is to, they have this class that they're dealing with, and how hard it is to be able to have differences of opinion of the people that had come talk, and how with their friends, they couldn't just say, I disagree with this person, this is not what I believe, and how to do that gracefully and wonderfully. And so to have teenagers openly talk about how difficult it is to live today and try and share their faith is exactly what we do. This is what we're about. And we're able to do this because of your generosity. And to the outside world, it looks like a bunch of teenagers goofing around. But to us inside, we know that it creates opportunities for these wonderful people to do
and talk about wonderful things. And so one of our membership vows is to support the church financially, which can be explained as being a part of our portion of our income, with a tithe being the goal. For those in the sanctuary, you are invited to come forward during the song and place your offering in the offering plates. If you have given electronically, we invite you to come forward and place the little green card, which you will find in the pews, representing your tithes and offering. You may give electronically by going to our website, firstinyourheart.org, and then clicking on Secure Giving on the right-hand column. By texting the dollar amount you want to give to 84321, or you may send your offering to the church by mail at 715 Diamond Drive, Los Alamos, New Mexico, 87544. Thank you for your faithfulness and generosity, and thank you for making a difference. We are God's love in action.
Give our thanks, our praise, our lives to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. One, two, three. Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit now with us. Every moment, all our days. God be praised. Oh, God be praised. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Son. Praise you, Spirit now with us. Every moment, all our days. God be praised. Oh, God be praised. God be praised. Oh, God be praised. God be praised. Oh, God be praised.
Another one of our expectations is that we'll be reading the Bible daily. And so to help you do that, in the scripture insert, you will find recommended scripture readings for each day of the week and a prayer for the week. The scripture reading for next Sunday, when we will continue our series looking at the fruit of the Spirit.
In Paul's letter to the Romans, he encourages us with the following. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. And if it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
So go forth to be peacemakers. And may the love of the Father, the strength of the Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.
Now go, be the church.
Did it all.